Okay, we've learned a lot of different things we can do with our Python code. Now we're going to talk a bit about how to call an API. Now, APIs are very powerful, but let's take a little step back to sort of understand how they fit into things. When you've written a function, or you've created a library, which we've just talked about, and you want to share that functionality, not just with yourself, but with other programmers, generally the way we do that is we create a web service. So we put our function onto a web server, just like you'd put a website onto a web server. And you need, if you have the address of the web server, just like if you have the address of a website, you can visit it. If you have the address of a web service, which is just a function stored on a web server, then somebody else could potentially call your function from another computer anywhere else in the world. This is where things start to get pretty neat. So if you have the address, so I have a web server called Contoso, and I'm actually going to use a real-world example here for the example web service I want to call. There is a neat little, and let me bring it up here, a thing called the Computer Vision API. So this is a really neat little function. What it does is it's a library, a whole series of functions that allow you to do things with images. And so you can pass in an image, and it'll tell you what's inside the image. So it does some artificial intelligence, data science, analyzing the image and returning you its contents, or you can pass it an image containing some text, and it'll tell you what text is actually read from the image, and so on. So if I wanted to call this computer vision API, and I want to call analyze image, so I want to pass in a picture, have it pass me back, tell me what's in that image, then I need to know, first of all, its address. So I need to have documentation from the person who created this web service to figure out how to call it. So in this case, it's a well-documented service, so I can go to the documentation on the site, and I can see the different addresses it might be using, and I can see the name of the function. So over here, when we say call, my code has to call it, basically I need to know that server name and the name of the method I'm calling. And these are examples of other services in the Computer Vision API that I might have chosen to call instead. So first of all, I need the address. So of course, if I'm calling a function, as we saw in the module on functions, when you call a function, you probably have to pass in parameters. Just because a function is stored on a web server doesn't change that fact. So I have to know the function name, and I have to know the parameters of the function I'm calling when I call a web service or an API. So again, if we return to the documentation, we can see all the function names listed here on the left-hand side for this particular documentation: analyze image, batch read file, detect objects, OCR, and so on. And if we scroll down, we can actually see the parameters. So you can see here are the parameters that this function expects when it's called. These are the parameters for analyze. So it expects me to pass in visual features. It tells me that's going to be a string, so I know the data type. And it even tells me what sort of information that is and what the valid values are I can pass in. And then it says there's a parameter called details and a parameter called language. So language, for example, if I specify English, that means when I say please analyze the image, return the results in English or return them in Spanish or Japanese. So that allows me to say if it sees a bear, it can return the word bear in English, Japanese, Spanish, and so on. So now I know my name and the parameters by looking up the documentation of the web service I'm calling. Now, here's the other interesting thing. If I just put my function up on a web server and put out the address, does that mean anybody in the world can just call it anytime they want? I probably want to have some way of controlling permissions of using it. Because if nothing else, I'm probably paying for an internet provider, and the traffic coming into my web service costs me money. So I might actually charge people to call my program. Or I might not. I might make it available for free. Depends on why I'm making it available. One of the ways we do that is by using keys. So one of the things we'll often see on websites and when we play with APIs and web services is you might say, what's your key? So generally speaking, there'll be a website you have to go to, or when you buy a license for your software, you're provided with a key. And that key is unique to you and gives you permission to call my web service. So when you call my web service and you pass me that key, I go, oh, I know that key. That's Susan's key. I remember she signed up for it, or she's paid for it, or she gave me the information I wanted to know so I could trust her to call my function. And once I know you have that key, then I'm like, okay, now I will let you call that function. So usually there's something you have to do, create an account, create a service or something, to get that key. And that key is basically your permission to call the function that's stored on this web server. Now, there's also a standard for the way we send messages across the web. It's called Hypertext Transfer Protocol. So when you see that HTTP everywhere, you see it on websites. You don't have to type http://www.whatever, but you'll see it all the time at the top of your browser. So basically, this is a protocol we use for talking across the internet. And there's two standard protocols we use for sending messages under HTTP. One's called GET and one's called POST. And if you actually go back again to our Computer Vision API, you can actually see here on the left, when I look at the documentation, it tells me, hey, Susan, if you want to call analyze image, you have to do a POST. If you want to call list domain specific models, you'll have to call GET. If you want to call OCR, that's going to be a POST. So the documentation will tell you which one you need to use. What's the difference between the two? It's subtle. The difference is with a GET command, you pass values to the function using something called a query string. So it's all part of that big long address. And if there's any special characters like slashes and stuff, you're going to need to use escape characters because it doesn't like special characters. So there's extra things you have to do to deal with those characters. It also has a limited amount of data that you can pass in because there's restrictions on how long that address can be when you put the query string on top of it. So that whole thing will appear in like the address bar of your browser. Now a POST, you can pass in values with that query string, but you can also pass in a message body. And that's much better, it can simplify things. You don't have to worry about if there's special characters in the body part. And also you can pass in more data. So that's what we typically use if we have to pass in a file. We'll usually use POST because when we put POST, we can put the file we want to pass in, the image we want to analyze can be put inside that body. So that's typically when we use a POST. And if we take a look here, the analyze image method, you'll notice it says I'm going to use a POST, which makes sense because I'm going to have to pass in the image, but I want this function to analyze for me and tell me what's in the image. Now, one of the things that's really useful in Python is something called the request library. So you just learned about libraries. Libraries are great, do all kinds of things to make our lives easier. And one of the libraries you want to use when you play with HTTP is called requests. Because what it does is it basically simplifies making a POST or a GET call. So you just import the request library. You'll have to do a pip install first, just as Christopher was talking about. And then you can call request.post. So I say, hey, I want to do a POST call, because I know that's what I need to do for analyze image. And if you look up the documentation on request.post, it will tell you you need to pass in an address. So the address is, what server is this on? What's the name of the function you're calling? That was on http://contoso/analyze. How do I know that? The documentation on the web service. See, these are the possible services it could be on. Here's the name of the function. Then I have to pass in the HTTP headers. Ah, scary stuff. No, don't panic. Go look at the documentation. If you take a look at the documentation for the analyze image, so here's documentation on analyze image, tells you doing a POST, and it will also tell me, by the way, here's the request headers. So it tells me when you pass it in, these are the values for the HTTP headers. You need to specify the content type and the subscription key. Ah, that's where I pass in that key that gives me the permission to call the API. Then the function parameters. The function parameters, that was the parameters. Look at the documentation. It told me here's the parameters that it expects and the acceptable values for the parameters. The documentation will vary depending on how good the and how organized the people are to create the API, but good documentation helps a lot. And then the message body. That is the image that I want to pass in. And how do I know that? Again, I know it because I looked here and in the documentation it said, hey, when you pass it in, you pass in a file, and it even tells me what file formats it'll accept. You can pass me a JPEG, a PNG file, GIF, can't be larger than 4 megabytes. So it even gives me some great parameters to help me increase the chance of success when I call it. So that's the image I want to pass in. So learning how to call APIs, or really learning how to go look up the documentation on the APIs and mapping that back to your calls, is going to unlock a whole new world for you. This is how you call neat services but already do neat stuff with data science to read text, analyze images, connect to third-party services. You're going to see it all over the place. The documentation is key. But let's go and take a look in actual code and call an API and see what it works like.